is finally and permanently discredited and abandoned. Everywhere is war. It's a war that until they're no longer.
Yeah, good morning to you, Guyana. Morning, everyone. I am here with you once again today. We're going to be looking at the state of the nation. Today's program, we have a very packed program for you today. And I hope that you, members of the public, you can participate in our discussion today. On one, first of all, I want to tell you that during the course of 2021, we will be encouraging persons who are interested in joining the Forbes Burnham Foundation, we'll be launching our membership drive. Because, you know, we, at the level of the foundation, our program primarily is to keep the legacy of Forbes Burnham alive and at the same time provide education for our young people in relation to our leaders of the past and the contribution to this, to the Cooperative Republic of Guyana in every sphere. So for 2021, that will be part of our program going forward, and I hope those of you who can remember, who have experienced this great man, that you can join us in this noble program of keeping his legacy alive. And we will continue to do just, whether you join us or not, this we feel we owe it to the nation at large to do just that. That's part of our discussion today, because we'll be looking at the program of the Forbes Burnham Foundation for the rest of this year. And you know, we plan our program each year, various activities to coincide with the work that's going on in Guyana. Then next, we're going to be looking at Black History Month. You know, tomorrow, 1st of February, Black History Month. We're going to be looking at Black History Month. You are free to call in and make your contribution. What you think needs to happen for Black History Month, we can talk about that. And then last and by no means least, we will be looking at the border controversy with our Western neighbor, the Bolivarian Republic of Venezuela. You know, that's a topical issue right now. And Lyndon Forbes Sampson Burnham was the person who really put us in a position, or has provided us with the information, data, the education in relation to our position on this, the border controversy. So those are the three areas mainly we're going to be looking at today, and I trust that you can join us on this program. Because with me today in the studio, phenomenal, you know, he wears a lot of hats, but he remains the chairman of the foundation, is Mr. Vincent Alexander. And first of all, kind of Vincent, our program of activities, I have a list of things that we have agreed on, but I trust I would like to start off by us looking at one. I've already outlined that we're going to be looking at our membership drive and try to encourage a lot of people to join us in this great task of keeping the legacy of Forbes Burnham alive. And we continue to do just. Could you give me some insights as to what we're going to be having this year, so our viewers can know exactly what we plan to do?
Thank you very much, Clayton, and good morning to our viewers. I think the first observation I need to make is that with COVID ongoing, our modus operandi obviously has to respond to that reality. And so much of what we will be doing during the course of the year so far, as we've planned it, will have to be done online. Will have to be done online in response to the realities of COVID. As that situation unfolds, we may return as much as possible to our face-to-face engagement, but for the time being, we envisage that much of what we do will have to be done online.
Yeah. Including our church service.
Including our church service.
Yeah.
As you know, February for us is a big month. Because February marks the birth anniversary of Lyndon Fobbs, Samson Burnham. And so we start off in the usual way this February. We're looking towards having our church service. As Clayton said, that's going to be accessible virtually, and we will at an appropriate time make the information on how to get online available for that. We are also having discussions with the Cycling Federation and the Table Tennis Federation so that we could have cycle race has been the practice over the years and the table tennis competition. The finalization of that will have to do with the permission given by the COVID Secretariat. So both federations are in touch with COVID and awaiting a response, and those responses will determine how we proceed with cycling and with table tennis. We will not have the cricket competition this year. That is a competition that brought together large numbers of young people. School is virtually out in some regards. On one hand, school is out, and on the other hand, it would be an assembly of a large number of people, and I don't think that that is in keeping with the protocols we are observing now for COVID, so there will be no cricket competition this year.
There are some questions being asked. There are people who are asking, persons in the diaspora have been asking, who knows Burnham, who knows about the great things that he has done for Guyana, and they're asking how they can become members. In our drive, how will we incorporate these persons who have interest to become membership of the
Well, you did mention, Clayton, that one of the things we are embarking on is a membership drive. And that drive involves both local people and people in the diaspora. In fact, the feeling is that COVID has presented us with the kind of opportunity we haven't in the past exploited for the engagement of the diaspora. Because once we do things virtually, creates the possibility that didn't exist before for people in the diaspora to be directly involved in our activities. So in fact, we have people out there who are scouting people in the diaspora to become members, and we have set ourselves some targets in terms of datelines for that to happen. We hope to have a big moment for the diaspora, because this year we'll also be having our usual conference. And for the first time, it's going to be a virtual conference. And that will allow for the diaspora to be actively involved in the conference as well. So we see this conference as an opportunity to take off in terms of a greater diaspora involvement. So that conference also comes up. I think it is scheduled for the 20th, if I'm not mistaken, of February. And that will be a virtual conference. So hope to make this a moment when the diaspora could really come on board with our content.
Yeah, I'm glad for that insight as to a few things that will be happening this year. I know for normal, we, like you said, we won't have our cycle race. We won't be having our cycle race. We won't have begin the cricket because of the schools involved. But our cycle race and the table tennis, we're talking to the associations about that. And then our concert, I don't know. We have in mind to have a concert in the month of December of this year.
The concert is way down in December. And again, that how that unfolds will depend on the situation in relation to COVID. So that's kind of a tentative arrangement. But throughout the year, we will have our normal quarterly meetings. And our quarterly meetings are not just business meetings. They're also educational meetings. So those two will take the form of being online for the educational part of the meeting. So that the public can join and share in the information which should be provided at those conferences, those meetings. We also plan to reinstitute the Elvin McDavid Symposium. Elvin McDavid, the late Elvin McDavid, is the founder member, founder patron of the Burnham Foundation. And we had agreed that we would mark his life with a symposium, We've done so on two occasions. We didn't have it last year, but that will be held in September. So we intend to reintroduce the Elvin McNavis Symposium. Mm. All of this is a part of our education program, because what we do this symposium is take the opportunity to deal with a topic of import to the country. McNavis is someone who always was involved in trying to share information. So we use that occasion for that purpose.
Mm. Just before we go off of that, how the members of the public, persons who are interested, how could they join?
What we are doing right now, even as we speak, we are doing some work on our website. It's down presently, but before the end of the month of February, the website will be up, and therefore persons will be able to go online on the website to join, as well as they can contact any of the members of the foundation who are the executive members if they wish to join. But it will be accessible online on our website, which we will be announcing shortly. Mm. Which will be announcing shortly.
Okay, great.
We have not mentioned the fact that we also propose to have our CARICOM brunch. This time a takeaway brunch.
Mm.
We've had this brunch for years. Last year was the only year we didn't have it because of COVID again. But we will reinstitute it. And
that's the 5th of July.
Yes, on the 5th of July, CARICOM Day. First Monday in July, we'll have that brunch. And it will be a takeaway brunch.
Well, there you have it. We have a little snippet as to the various activities that will take place for the rest of this year. And I think those of you who have an interest to become a part of the foundation very soon, like Mr. Alexander said, you can access the information and join up online so that you can be part of this program that we always hold annually to observe and to keep the legacy of Forbes Burnham alive. Black History Month, the month of February. Guyana is multi-ethnic society, and the history of blacks in the Caribbean is one of interest all around the world. And Black History Month, tell me something, how did they come about this? Is it a decision of the UN to?
Black History Month has its origin essentially in the United States.
Mm.
Did not start as Black History Month. It started as a movement among the Negroes in the United States, a movement to do two things. One, to seek recognition of the African Americans for what they're worth, and also to continue forward in the struggle as a part of the civil rights movement. It evolved over time, where it got to the point that it went beyond America, became active in the United States, in the United Kingdom, became active in Canada, and virtually across the globe. And the continuous work and its metamorphosis led to a point where the United States gave recognition to it as an important day on the calendar of the United States. I think subsequent United Kingdom gave recognition as well. Canada gave recognition. So it became something universally accepted. And so it is now on the UN calendar, more or less, as well, as a month that is organized across the globe in recognition of black people, so to speak, and to highlight the role that they have played in human civilization, to highlight the struggle that's ongoing for their recognition.
I just want to say, in this country, say Guyana, our organizations that are involved in kind of promoting Black History Month seems to me as though in the past they were a little fractured, little group here observing various activities, in their kind of community. And in most instances, those things are done in August, 1st of August, and during the month of August, some people observe it, what you call Freedom Day. And now you have the organizations now are now trying to put together a structured approach in terms of commemorating these various activities each year. Now, what has changed over the years in relation to the observance or recognition of the contributions of blacks to development of this country?
I think in the main, ACDA was the organization that organized activities for Black History Month. They were the organization that did that. I think we've also had some things being organized by reparations initially, and then other black organizations came on board. So what in fact happened, the organizations in their own right organized activities to mark Black History Month. So ACDA, as I said, was upfront in that regard. Reparations, Coffee 250, and various communities sometimes also organize things. But I think it's interesting to note that one of the things about Black History Month is about the recognition of the role that people of African descent would have played in the world at large and the civilization mm-hmm. of the world, as well as the role that they played in America, particularly in their attempt to overcome enslavement and in the struggle for human rights. Mm-hmm. Human rights, the human rights movement, the after the abolition of slavery. Now that is tied significantly to the question of recognition of people. And I think it's important to note that the UN itself came around to a recognition of the need for recognition when they in fact made the declaration of a decade to people of African descent, a decade which spans 2015 to 2024. So this year, like previous years, we are having this History Month in a decade, which itself takes on board recognition, because the theme of the decade is recognition, justice, and development. So this whole thrust of the History Month falls within mm-hmm. the activities of what the decade speaks to. And one may well say that the decade itself becomes a part of the ongoing movement mm-hmm. of black people, people of African descent, for recognition, justice, and development. I think one should then have to look at the Ghana situation and to apply it to the Ghana situation. Because I think what we are still struggling for in Ghana is the recognition of the contribution that people of African descent have made to this country. There are tremendous efforts not to acknowledge that. And not only the recognition of the contribution they have made, but the struggles that they have gone through. And the fact that having come to Guyana enslaved, mm-hmm. having been enslaved for over 200 years, that they suffer tremendous disadvantages as people, disadvantages both material and psychological. And the state has evolved in such a way that it has not sought to redress those disadvantages, so that the disadvantages are still in many ways present, particularly the psychological disadvantage, one of which is a non-recognition of the role that African Guyanese have played in the development of Guyana. And so this month for people of African descent is very important, because it kind of spikes the ongoing struggle for their recognition and for redress and even for reparations. So the month is very, very critical in terms of raising the consciousness of people of African descent themselves, above themselves, as well as raising the consciousness of bringing to other people the awareness of the role mm-hmm. that people of African descent have played universally and here in Guyana in particular. Because it is that consciousness that will allow people to be responsive to the call of people of African descent mm-hmm. for their recognition, for their justice and development. So this month is very, very important in terms of continuing. It's not a one-off something, but it's a very important month in terms of giving some emphasis mm-hmm. to the ongoing struggle of people of African descent for their recognition, for their justice and development, and ensuring that among themselves they are aware. You know, one of the disadvantages we suffer from is our education system does not speak wholesomely to the role of people of African descent. We do not have history sufficiently taught in our education system to give recognition to the role of all peoples in some regards, with respect to Guyana, but here we are more concerned about the role of people of African descent. So I wonder that this month is highly, most of the activities are highly educational to make people aware and to make them conscious and to bring mm-hmm. them to a recognition mm-hmm. of the role that people of African descent have played and what they have suffered historically.
I know that you are a man that wears many hats, and the fact that the UN has designated 10 years, a decade, for people of African Guyana descent, for Guyana governments around the world to perhaps place emphasis in recognizing black people in the various countries of the world. As head of IPADGI, is there any program that the government has made known to black organizations in relation to what will be happening for the month of February and going forward?
Well, I am not aware of a program that the government has articulated. One would think that under the ministry responsible for culture, that there could be such an articulation of a program, but I have not heard of such a program. But that mm-hmm. notwithstanding, the International Decade for People of African Descent Assembly Guyana is itself articulating a program. And I'm quite sure, and not quite sure, I know for a fact that AGDI will be doing, having activities as well. But I can speak more intimately about the International Decade for People of African Descent, which is articulating a month-long program for this month. And the program will be sponsored by two organs of the decade. One will be the Education Committee, which will in fact be kicking off its program tomorrow, when it will be addressing the question of the origination mm-hmm. of the month. And so tomorrow evening at 7 p.m. on this very channel, we will be kicking off that program. And that program will be having an activity every week. The activities will take the form of publications in the papers. Those publications will seek to do a number of things. On one hand, they will seek to speak about Africa itself, kind of a fact sheet in Africa, because there's a lot of information about Africa that has not been known, that has been swept under the carpet by certain interests. And so one of the first things we will do is be bring it out. Simple facts, mm-hmm. simple facts, not opinions. Simple facts about Africa, which people need to know if they are to give the kind of recognition to the role mm-hmm. of Africa's played in human civilization. Then we are going to be also doing a publication that seeks to speak to science, technology, engineering, arts, and mathematics, mm-hmm. and the role that people of African descent and Africans at large have played in the world's development of science, technology, engineering, arts, and maths. Again, that's an area that is highly ignored, the significant contribution that from time immemorial, because science has its origin, maths has its origin in the continent of Africa. And apart from that origin, people of African descent across the globe have continued to be significant contributors to the development of science, technology, engineering, arts, and mathematics. And so we are going to use the opportunity to highlight but a few of those people who have made such significant contributions. So that's going to be another publication that we're going to have. We're also going to be doing a publication on prominent Guyanese of African descent who have contributed significantly to Guyana in particular. Mm-hmm. And so that's another thing we are going to be doing during the course of the month. We will also, during the course of the month, we're also going to host a concert, virtual, that highlights the talents of young African Guyanese, to bring to the fore young African Guyanese in a virtual concert.
I have listened to you carefully, and I know people out there are thinking, I have advocated on this program many months before, many years before. What you have just said fits into my advocacy in relation to our education system. I have suggested, I don't know whether the Ministry of Education or the state or your agency, this proposal, there is a need for a bipartisan team to look at our history specifically, Guyanese history, which would incorporate all those things that your organization is attempting to do in terms of providing information, education to our people in relation to the contribution of people of African Guyana descent to Guyana and Guyana's development. I am very hopeful that as part of your program for the month the month of February, that you can include that as well.
Well, we have not left it a month to do that. Mm-hmm. We have, from the very inception, been pushing for the inclusion of history in our school curriculum, and to ensure that much more is done, and it's presently being done. In that regard, our General Assembly had in fact passed the motion, and we had, as a consequence of that motion, written to the last Minister of Education on this matter, the previous regime, and we have since been in touch with the current officials of the Ministry of Education, and they have given us the undertaking that in a process that's presently ongoing, and that's the process of curriculum reform, that they will take on board the need for ramping up the teaching of Guyanese history. And our concern there is that in that teaching, that they recognize the role African Guyanese have played. So this is a work in progress as far as we're concerned. We've also heard that there's supposed to be some revision done at the CXC level, the Council for Education.
Okay.
Caribbean Council for Education. You know, it happens that Professor Hilary Beckles, the Vice Chancellor of the University of the West Indies, is also the Chairman of the Reparations Commission of CARICOM, and is also the Chairman of the Caribbean Council for Education, CXC. And so one would expect that, given where he resides, wearing those various caps, that he would be very active in ensuring that CXC also addresses this question. So it's not just Guyana. We should not wait on CXC. I think we need to ensure, and the Ministry of Education did say to us, that the focus will be between, I think, grade 3 and grade 9, in terms of the curriculum providing for Guyanese history. For the time being, they will have to fall in line from grade 10 to grade 12 for the purposes of CSEC. mm-hmm. to follow that syllabus. But before that, the children will have a great exposure to Guyanese history. And so, in a sense, recalling on the people from CXC who have themselves said that this is a matter that is to be addressed, mm-hmm. that they ensure that more attention is paid to the history of people of African descent across the Caribbean.
In all the countries.
In the history syllabi mm-hmm. of CXC.
All right. That's a lot. And I trust that there will be some positive
response.
But
I haven't concluded what we are doing locally. We also have two other activities which are worthy of mention. Mm-hmm. This young poet laureate, Grumman, mm-hmm. did a fantastic poem at the inauguration of
President Biden.
President Biden. Mm-hmm. And it has been the popular view that the poem is relevant not only to America and Biden's inauguration, but it says a lot that is relevant to the awakening of people of African descent. And so we are hoping to have a rebroadcast of an interview she did in which she explained how she came about this particular
to put together the poem.
And to have a commentary done after that so that we can use the moment of her poem also to highlight the month, to highlight a young black African-American who seems to be a rising star, showing again the talent that inheres in people of African descent. But more than that, to have a commentary in the poem itself to understand the importance and significance of that work of poetry.
Careful
to the people,
words
to
chosen.
The people of African descent. So we're going to have that as well. And we will close the month with an interview of elders in the African community speaking to their own experiences and their own struggles as people of African descent in this pursuit of recognition for people of African descent. That's what we will close the month.
That's a wonderful program, and I trust that you, the public out there, you can become involved in these things because it will be highlighted, like Mr. Alexander said, on the radio and on the television. And I want to remind you those things that we have spoken about earlier on our program, including the observance of the Black African Month. Black History Month. You can call in. The lines will be open very soon. So you can call in as well, make a contribution, ask your questions, and make any comment you may wish to make in relation to those programs. One, your involvement, whether you want to be part of our program going forward on the Faust Bonham Foundation, if you want to become a member. Secondly, a Black History Month observance begins tomorrow, and we have a long list of activities that will be taking place during this month, and I hope that you will keep your ears to the ground and be in tune and participate in these activities. Vincent, I want to switch gear to another topic I mentioned earlier on, and that is the border controversy between Guyana and Venezuela. It's a hot topic right now, and quite recently there have been some incursions, not only incursions in our waters, but there have been some, what I will call, kind of kidnapping. Some people have described the disposition of the Venezuelan army as kidnapping Guyanese on the boat and taking them back to Venezuela. Now, the border controversy. Your thoughts on this one? What is it that is really happening?
The first thing I would wish to say on that, Clayton, and it comes directly from what you just said, is that there is a border controversy. And why am I emphasizing that there is a border controversy? I'm emphasizing that because the borders between and among Guyana, Brazil, and Venezuela were determined in 1899 with the agreement of all
parties.
Three parties, and that agreement came about through a tribunal that was an international tribunal that sat. All of the parties were involved, and all of the parties agreed. In that process, I think Guyana at that time lost a significant part of what was considered to be a part of British Guyana. I think Brazil lost a bit as well.
That's right.
And Venezuela was the main beneficiary of that process. And so the border is something that has been signed on to.
Settled.
And settled in 1899. For whatever reason, I think that there's a lot of politics involved, international politics involved. But for whatever reason, as we got close to independence in 1966, the Venezuelans unearthed or disclosed, put into the public domain, I don't know which of the words really to use, a letter which they said was written by one of the persons who participated in that process, but who asked that the letter should only be published posthumously.
When
only be published
when
after
he's dead.
He's dead. And so this letter was brought into the public domain, and the letter seeks to contend that there was some collusion among parties that were involved in the tribunal, collusion in favor of Guyana. Now, so the Venezuelan case in this controversy has only this one leg, that this man wrote a letter to see that something occurred. There is no evidence of the occurrence. There is nobody else, no one else given witness. He himself refused to be witnessed by virtue of writing this letter and asking that it be posthumously made public. So on the eve of independence, this is what the Venezuelans came up with, and have been very, very aggressive ever since, both in terms of what they do internally in Venezuela to mobilize the mass around this call for what they call the reclamation. And in their map, they have this part they call Zone Reclamacion. And they're educating all the Venezuelans that this is a part of Venezuela. So coming out of what happened prior to independence, of course you were then British Guyana, there was an agreement that was signed as to how this matter would be interrogated, how the matter of the controversy. There was never any acceptance by British Guyana at the time, or Guyana subsequently, that there is a border dispute. There's always been the maintenance that this border was determined in 1899. Everybody signed onto that treaty determining the border, but here you are bringing up a matter that is making some controversy about the signing rather than the content of what was determined. And so we signed on to the Geneva Agreement, which outlined the process for interrogating this controversy, a process which was intended, first of all, to see a certain level of engagement between the countries. We know of the establishment of the good officers who were supposed to be speaking on this matter. And this has been going on for years. During that period, we've had suffered some problems. We suffered when the Venezuelans occupied the half of Ancoca, which is the an island in the Cayuni, where our border runs through that island, and they have occupied the entire island. That's an illegal occupation of the island. We suffered even more significantly when Guyana wanted to build a hydropower station in the Mazaruni. Lots of people don't remember this. Burnham was a visionary, and hydropower was seen as a very critical to Guyana's development. It was envisaged that if we could get hydropower, then we could then smelter aluminum, it's aluminum. And aluminum is a very important material used in industry. That would have taken Ghana places. And so we sought to embark on the hydro project. In that regard, two bodies were established in Ghana, the Upper Mazrooni Development Authority. And the Upper Mazrooni Development Authority was intended to deal with the very process of developing the hydro, resettling the people that was going to be required. And we also established an Upper Mazrooni Road Development Project.
UMRP.
UMRP Road Project. And that project was intended to build the road to the site of the hydro. And in fact, work started in that road. Some of the money that we got from the good sugar price in the late, in the 70s, was dedicated to that exercise of building the road. And that much of the work then, Ghana is still a beneficiary of, because those roads are still there and can still be used. But the Venezuelans intervened at that time and stymied our effort to get a World Bank loan to build the hydro. So, you know, many people out there criticize Burnham for all sorts of things and do not really understand the way in which the work of Burnham was hampered along the way. And this was a significant part of that work which was hampered. For a very long time as well, Ghana could not be a member of the Organization of American States because of this controversy and because of the disposition of the Venezuelans in that regard. We couldn't be in the OAS for a very long time. And so the Venezuelans have repeatedly been hammering out this contention to the point where, under the Geneva Agreement, the government of Ghana, the process of the good offices not having given us any benefits, any results, any outcomes, decided that they will use the provisions in the agreement, which says if after a certain time this process of good offices is not successful, then what do? That we go to the UN and allow the UN to determine
the Secretary General
how next we go forward. Because even the good offices are under the UN. And Ghana went forward in that regard. And the UN has decided, the Secretary General, that the way to go is to use the International Court to make a determination on this matter. And the International Court has since been dealing with the matter. They have given both Ghana and Venezuela an opportunity to present their cases. What the court did in the first instance was to make a determination as to whether they had jurisdiction. Because Venezuela was trying to say the court does not have jurisdiction, that they will not adhere to any decision of the court. So the court, in the first instance, allowed both parties to put forward their dispositions as to whether the court has a jurisdiction or not. And the court, by an overwhelming majority, has determined that it has jurisdiction. So we now move into the point where the court is to determine the controversy. Is there any merit in the contention that somebody colluded with someone else to arrive at these boundaries? Venezuela has continued to say that the court doesn't have jurisdiction and they will not adhere to the decision of the court, and have in fact upped their activity through a number of things, by decrees. You know, they claim our land, and in international law, your landmass is associated to adjacent waters. And the adjacent waters gives you, in the first instance, your very boundary, and then it extends it an economic zone.
Yeah, to 200 miles.
200 miles economic zone. And so that what Venezuela has sought to do is to say, since we are claiming, and since we are saying that the school belongs to us, then the projection into the sea, the Atlantic Ocean, off of Essequibo, is also
theirs.
And here is where we've had the problem recently, where they have come into that area and have in fact detained, arrest, kidnapped two boats and the personnel on the boats. It was a previous occasion too when a few years ago there was an oil rig that was interfered with as well in the same area. And so we are now faced with a situation where there is aggression, and it calls for what has been done in the past for the country to unite and to do all it can. Our first line of defense obviously is diplomacy, but it also requires a mobilization internally. And again here we see the policies of Burnham, because Burnham was successfully mobilized internally whenever these incidents occurred, and it's against that background that Burnham created the Ghana People's Militia. Every citizen
a soldier.
Every citizen a soldier had nothing to do with what people tend to say about politics. It had to do with ensuring that in the face of aggression that we were sufficiently militarized as a people to be able to defend our territory.
I was just coming to that part because I am very peeved about the response so far from our government in relation to this spurious and strange claim by Venezuela. Because when this thing first came to the fore in the 70s, late 60s, going to 60s, Venezuela then and Guyana then, like you rightly said, I was young then, I had hair in my head then, but then I remember distinctly all schools in every region you could have gone to, and there was a definite program in schools, in the communities, in the various organizations in Georgetown where people were in tune with everything that was happening. And I remember at the Ministry of Information, they used to be churning out leaflets like every 2 weeks, something about providing education as to what needs to be done by our people. Now with this aggression that has been displayed again, you're not seeing this kind of response in the country. What is happening? And when Forbes Burnham was leading the charge in those years, people all over this country were in tune, they were informed, educated as to what was happening, what needs to be done. But you're not seeing that now. What is happening?
The president had I don't know what they call it, a press conference or what, I'm not sure how to refer to it, but he did speak to the question yesterday and has promised that work is being done and that soon you will see. I hope sooner than later you will see much more being done in terms of public education. So he did make that undertaking yesterday. He called for unity. I'd like to make some observations in that regard.
Yeah, well, I'd be glad to because I'm going to be opening the lines just you're through with that.
The first observation I want to make is that the team that Forbes Burnham had put together to deal with this matter, the government has found it necessary in prosecuting its case to retain much of that team. And again, it points to the significant contribution, the legacy of Burnham, that those persons he identified are still the persons who are largely the local lawyers involved with the Ramphal, Scotland, the international diplomat, Jackson, and these people are still mainstream in this. And it shows you a way in which a nation should really depend on its professionals, on its talented people to take it forward and not to be involved in partisan activities when it comes to matters of nation building. And I'm saying that because of this. The president has said that all Guyana is united and all of that in this matter. He said that. Whenever we had an incident at the time of Forbes Burnham, one of the first persons Forbes Burnham would engage is the leader of the opposition. One of the first persons he would engage is the leader of the opposition. Mm-hmm. We still have a charade here where people are actual government. And you have a matter like this, and you see an uptick moment with a member of parliament speaking to the Minister of Foreign Affairs. But you have not seen an engagement between the president and the leader of the opposition. The president represents, in terms of what has been declared through the recount, a majority, a slim majority mm-hmm. of the Guyanese people. The leader of the opposition represents a large minority. The difference is not great. There's a difference of 2 seats between the parties. And we have not seen an engagement of the leader of the opposition by the president.
It was an indictment on
and
the
I
part
think
of
that
the government.
Is an indictment. And you can talk all you want about unity. If you cannot recognize that you are factually in government, forget all the who say you're not or all of that, you're factually in government. And we are confronting an adversary. And you are talking about unity.
I am not meeting with the leader of the opposition.
And I want to go further into this idea that all Guyanese are being called upon to unite, to defend the territory, mm-hmm. territorial integrity of Guyana. Guyanese, in defending the territorial integrity of Guyana, have to feel that they are really
part of
this
the
action.
Process. Correct. I agree.
And for
with
them
that.
To feel they are part of this action, they cannot be victims in terms of being able to get jobs, being able to retain jobs. Those things are demotivating factors mm-hmm. in an environment where you want all Guyanese to be united. Because people don't unite just because you call upon them to unite. They unite because they belong, because it's a part. But when you take away their jobs and they don't have opportunities, then the sense of belonging is being interfered with. And so it's important, I think this is an important moment, not only for us to confront the question of uniting for Venezuela, but for us to confront the question of Guyanese being treated mm-hmm. as Guyanese and being treated in a manner that allows them to benefit from the patrimony of the country mm-hmm. in which they belong. Mm-hmm.
Okay, comrade, where the lines are now open, you are free to make your call, make a contribution. We can remember the areas we have looked at, our program for this year, the Forbes Burnham Foundation. We have looked at Black History Month and what is happening. And lastly, but by no means least, we are looking at the border and controversy with the Bolivarian Republic of Venezuela. So you can make your calls now, and I think that those points that were made right last year by Mr. Alexander are very, very significant points, because at this point in time, it is so important that all Guyanese feel that they're part of this whole movement to confront the Venezuelans in relation to this spurious claim that they're making in relation to our territory. And it is not a matter that should be done the way it is being done right now, where people are asking all sorts of questions. People are not feeling anything in relation to, and you said the president have spoken to this matter and are saying that there will be something happening. I think the things that need to happen need to have happened 2 days ago or 2 weeks ago. But we haven't seen that yet. I am hopeful that, take the president to his word, that things will happen quickly, indicating clearly that all Guyanese are on board and all Guyanese should be on board in relation to this claim, Vincent. I don't know. No, we missed that one. Yeah, those points I don't know, but when I was younger, I remember this thing distinctly, and I heard the song being played. Dave Martin, I think he was kind of commissioned directly to do a song in relation to it. I'm not sure.
He responded to the crisis at the time.
Yes.
And made that song.
Morning, you on the air.
Morning, I need to ask a question.
Yes, sir.
Is the president of Guyana all Guyanese?
Well, that's what he says.
He's talking from the air. I know that don't really mean nothing. It's true what Vincent said. During Bonham time, he contact Jagon.
Yes.
During all the rest of the contact, who to contact for the opposition. Today, the president, there's a sham and a charade, in fact. And a mockery to all Guyanese people. God, I don't know what the president really feel like. He got his own army. He got no own army. He just look, have a blessed day.
But it's a very serious issue, and we shouldn't be having this kind of problem. There's a matter that need everybody on board. And as I said before, I remember distinctly, schools, communities were mobilized, and by no means least I remember is at that same time, I didn't even remember that the Guyanese People's Militia came on board. Because I remember the slogan, every citizen a soldier. And on that score, Forbes Burnham created the Guyanese People's Militia with a view to ensuring that Guyanese know their history, know what is happening, know what they have to defend. Morning, you're on the air.
Good morning, Brad. How are you?
I'm really making out, sir.
Yeah, I'm just here watching and enjoy your program, but this is Rastaman that used to drive bus from Sapphire.
Yes, buddy, yeah.
From there.
Mm.
You know, we'll be talking about Black History Month.
Mm.
But there's no one month that's enough to talk about Black History.
I agree with you.
I've been teaching history and comparative religion at China 9 for a little while.
Mm.
Then I encounter a problem with GNBA.
Mm-hmm.
This is that I'm speaking too much of black things.
Really?
I'm talking about, yes, that's what Miss Eve told me. She was to show me a letter, but I never did see it. Now, you said I wanted to know if I'm a medical doctor. Because I'm speaking about healing, your heart going back here. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
You understand?
Mm-hmm.
So I told her, I said, it's within me, it's within my DNA.
Mm-hmm.
Anyhow, I had to come out of the program.
Mm-hmm.
And I contacted this organization by region and ownership several times.
Mm.
All I wanted for them was to give me, you know, just 3 sponsorship, pay for 3 programs, not give me the money, but pay me time.
Mm.
And I had the royal one on the rock. Twice I've been to them and asked them for a laptop or a tablet. Because by then, I would already got an online radio station.
Okay.
I was needed to, you know,
mm-hmm.
broadcast. Unto this day, they took my number, they're going to call me, they're going to this. Unto this day, they never, ever contacted me. You mm-hmm. understand?
Yes. I understand your concern.
Huh?
I understand your concern.
Yeah, you know what they remind me of? That interview with a Nigerian. And a man from Dubai.
Mm.
In Nigeria, the man from Dubai says that because of the prosperity that they were experiencing, even though they didn't have the resources that Nigeria had, it's because they had the right people in the right places.
Mm.
We have too many Negroes in black people affairs. We have too many house slaves.
After now, when I meet you, you're going to explain to me the difference.
the Negroes is your slave.
Yeah.
And, you know, coffee pan in a rebellion.
Hmm. All right.
After, okay. You know, Accra coming.
Hmm.
When you bite my sick, you know me sick today.
Hmm.
I defiled everything. You understand what I mean?
All right, brother.
No problem, sir. I experienced the same thing with Agda.
Hmm.
I could hope that we would get black people at the helm of black people at the thing.
Hmm. All right.
They tell me they don't have no money, they never get no money and that kind of thing.
I'm going to ask Mr. Alexander to respond. I don't know if he wished to see
some. We're going to meet up, Brother Heist. I ain't driving no more, but we're going to meet up.
All right, good. Thanks for calling. Thanks for calling.
Come on.
All right, good. Our time is running out, but I think we can be able to take one more call if the persons are listening to this program. You have three areas we discussed this morning. One, our border controversy with Venezuela. Black History Month that begins tomorrow with the month of February 2021. Lots of things are happening. Morning, you're on the air.
Morning.
Morning.
Morning, sir.
Morning, you're on the air.
Yes, good morning.
Yes. I'm hearing you.
Just turn that TV down.
Please turn your television down.
I could remember when I was a school child.
Please turn the television down. Yeah.
Yes, sir.
Yes.
I remember when I going to school, I heard music play. Not a play of brass band is bigger. You know, you don't hear these things, these children, this generation was great to know.
Yeah.
At school and so on.
Yeah, well, that's what we're saying. There is not any program in relation to our response to this aggression by Venezuela. And I'm hopeful, like Mr. Alexander said, that something will happen very shortly. Our
yes,
time is running out. I think you should make a point a little quickly.
This generation should know about this.
Yes, they should. I agree with you fully.
They
should be an aggressive program. In fact, there are lots of Guyanese don't even know that the Venezuelans have seized or have captured or have kidnapped. Yeah. Our citizens and the boat in our territory. A lot of Guyanese doesn't know that. But these are things that are happening as we speak, and there has been what I will call a very lukewarm, or what I will call lackluster response from our government.
That's right. Mm. That's right. We need to teach the children more about this.
Yeah.
Yeah,
thanks for calling. Thanks for calling. Time is running, and I just might ask the operator to allow me one more call if another call is on the line. Thank you for calling. Yes, Anna Vincent, I think she's a very passionate, very passionate caller. She said she feels that people should really know these things that are happening, I'm not seeing anyone coming through right now. So what I would like to say at this point is that we have attempted in a very simple way to try to provide information for you. One, about our organization, what we'll be doing for this year. We have also outlined what program will be on stream for Black History Month, for the month of February. And we have looked, and lastly, but by no means least, as to this critical issue of the border controversy with Venezuela. I have been your host for this program, but before I leave, I want to ask Vincent to say a few words before we close at this point.
Well, I think there are two things we need to focus on. We are going into Black History Month, and I think we need to be tuned in for all of the activities that are going to mark that, because it's critical to lifting our own consciousness and our awareness about people of African descent the world over, what they have gone through, and what contributions they have made towards civilization and the ongoing struggle for their recognition, justice, and development.
Mm.
Also, that the Bornham Foundation wishes to encourage you to be involved in our activities throughout the year as we seek to continue the legacy of Lyndon Fobbs Sampson Burnham, a legacy which is evident in almost everything in this country, and more critical even at this time when we are once again being, the threat of the Venezuelans is being heightened. We have to go back to the thoughts and the visions and the strategies of Lyndon Fobbs Sampson Burnham, to again ward them off in their attempts as we continue with the action in the court, an action which has eventuated from an agreement which Burnham was party to, as we sought to address this controversy from the very inception.
All right. Once again, thank you very much for having me in your living room and your hallway, your kitchen and your bathroom. And I will be with you again the fourth Sunday in the month of February when we bring to you another program, The State of the Nation.
The color of a man's skin is of no more significance than the color.